we were just kind of adding up. So in the last, six or 7 years, we have done so many pictures together. We work either through Ron Howard or John Lee Hancock or for Jay Roach, and we kind of do almost everything that kind of comes down the pike that way. And so we have been very sort of joined at the hip in terms of our research, in terms of doing period things like Frost Nixon, in terms of researching, the HBO picture Game Change, the Sarah Palin picture.
Game Change, yes.
And so kind of those sorts of politics. So Daniel and I sort of have a long and fruitful sort of collaboration.
So the combination, is this something you guys kind of just decided we probably should be teamed up on things, or
happened that we kind of gravitated, or certain directors had kind of gravitated toward us as individuals, and the same with Mr. Schwartzman as well. This was his second John Lee Hancock picture. This is our
third,
right? And so and then other directors kind of, not in terms of cherry picking crew, but basically we seem to make a nice salt and pepper shaker in some ways. And so consequently find ourselves kind of, in association with the same directors repeatedly, or coming back on the same projects. And so kind of the continuity that the two of us have really makes us go further faster.
And the continuity with the directors, I assume,
the directors as well. Absolutely. Yes.
So is it do any of these directors zag when you expect them to zig, or is it you kind of see it coming?
I think that because Daniel and I are generally in so early that that we have the ability to kind of begin shaping the material together. So a lot of times we research in tandem. And then these are all things that you may want to ask us sort of about formally. And so basically sort of...
I'm very informal.
And so our research...
You're kind of doing the work for me.
And so our research into... particularly into the world of Walt, kind of happened in parallel, in that Daniel and I, there was an exhibit at the Reagan Library in Simi Valley, which was the Treasures of Disney Archives. Mm-hmm. And a day or two before that was going to open to the public, we were invited to come sort of for a preview and to be behind the velvet rope and to really start looking at the layout of Walt's office, starting to kind of breathe in the textures and the fabrics and sort of wanting to know all about that. And I'd like to talk about that a little bit in greater detail. Mm-hmm. But Daniel joined me there, so we were there together for the very first time. And then I believe it must have been our first trip to the Disney photo archives, mm-hmm. that Daniel and my set decorator Susan Benjamin and I sort of went out to kind of have the run of the Disney photo archives, and we all kind of split the work up and divvied it into different sections where we kind of, we were choosing things that were really going to be sort of illuminating to kind of what we needed to be doing regarding the world of Walt. But then we were picking images in tandem, mm-hmm. and we were sharing images in tandem. And I think that first trip we returned, our wish list between the three of us was close to 300 images.
Oh yeah. Absolutely.
Well, your wish list of...
We went with a group of questions. This is what we need to see. What this looks like, what this looks like, what this looks like, what this looks like. And, and then we went through folders of contact sheets looking, we need this shot.
And is there anything that you guys have done that is as well archived as Disney?
Mm. Oh, yes, NASA.
NASA. NASA was pretty well archived, and in some ways the interviews for Frost Nixon were very, very well archived.
Yes.
And so we have the ability for both of us really to kind of work at reverse engineering, mm-hmm. from these archival things. This has become something that we've gotten to be sort of very accustomed to and sort of do very well together. And also Game Change was very well archived, because that was a very promiscuous sort of mixture of archival footage that was being cut in, mm-hmm. to new and stage footage, including things like the vice presidential debate, the Katie Couric interviews. And so all of those things, whenever we were sort of mixing archival things with the Sarah Palin, sort of with Julianne Moore kind of standing in that way, that Daniel truly had to be just spot on. And I had to be good enough that these things could actually be intercut between the actual vice presidential debate and footage that we were staging. And so we've really kind of been very, very, very accustomed to this.
Yeah, we've done a lot of movies, both of us in tandem and separately, about real people. Mm-hmm. So you have to do the research, because you owe it to whoever they're recreating in the film, to the real person, to be as truthful as possible.
Is it easier or harder?
Easier in some ways, harder in other ways.
And so, for instance, and we don't want to stray too far from topic. You'll edit this kind of to make
stray,
sense.
Stray.
But we did The Blind Side together.
Mm-hmm. And so another real person,
another real family. And so the character that Sandra Bullock played, Leanne Tui, was a very formidable individual in and of herself, and she was an interior decorator in real life. And so there is a very particular Southern decorating style that we wanted to sort of get to the heart of, but it really becomes finding that line between character and caricature. And so Daniel and I are always kind of cross-checking with one another here, because things that it would have been very simple in a case like that to have gone a little bit cartoony, sort of a little bit beyond the pale, when in actuality we kind of had to sort of pull it back a little bit so it seemed plausible and credible. But then generally Daniel is usually aware of what my key frames are, what my key palette decisions are going to be, as equally I'm completely aware of what his hero pieces are. And so we can work sort of back and forth toward each end. We can kind of work toward a middle where we kind of meet in that middle.
So what are your hero pieces in Saving Mr. Banks?
Oh, well, certainly Emma's clothes as P.L. Travers. We wanted the director, the actress, and I wanted, they expect this little old lady to come in that they will bowl over with the magic of Disney. Mm-hmm. And we wanted her to be this formidable presence. And she was not giving them an inch. We even, you know, she arrives with a coat in, you know, sunny Southern California, and her tweeds and her, you know, fine English tailoring. And she will not even give up the coat. So that's the thing, and we gave her this big alligator handbag that she said, this is my shield, and you can see her like holding it up, protecting herself from this onslaught of Disney. So that those were our key pieces, and we wanted her to seem completely opposite to the casual nature of the Disney studio.
And then also a summer palette versus an autumnal palette was very important to us. And so the fact that she was sort of standing sort of in contrast to this bright California sunlight and these greens and sort of the greens and the summer colors that you had dressed the Walt staff, the Secretary of the Interior and Exterior. So there were always these contrasts that were at play. But by the same token, by going with autumnal colors, this began to be more evocative of her memories of her childhood in Allora. And so these concepts dovetailed very, very nicely. And then you kind of took those cues where I became kind of a dominant palette, sort of the scenery, the geography, the flora, just sort of the vibe of Australia 1906. Then you sort of played against that with a more neutral and black and white palette.
Well, bleached out, you know, the sun of Allora, we wanted it. And it's also working class people, and, you know, suits were black.
Though I guess John was talking about the fact that Dusty was kind of the theme for him.
Yes.
he was certainly dusty. And he was saying how you guys also interact quite a bit before he goes out to shoot.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
That it's really a group effort. Is that normal for every director? Is that particularly John Lee Hancock thing? Or?
I think it is. I would say that I think for the caliber of director that we have kind of risen to, this that our process is one that we bring with us sort of regardless of who we're working with, but also wise and sage directors are certainly smart enough to be attuned to casting as adroitly behind the camera as they are casting in front of the camera. Mm-hmm. And so the fact that there is an ensemble rapport that Daniel and I bring to this process immediately really sort of minimizes conflict, and I believe sort of helps that we're both interested, as opposed to it being necessarily a Darwinian process where I bring idea A, Daniel brings idea B, and one is dominant over the other. Mm-hmm. Frequently what happens is our idea A and idea B synthesize into a better idea C that is that really comes from both of us in a lot of ways.
So is that just the mindset of this group of people that gets back together to work? Is there sometimes a bully in the group that wants to have their way and that's all that really matters?
No, movie making is very collaborative. and it's sharing ideas. You know, no director is going to say no to a good idea. And no costume designer, no production designer, if somebody comes along with a really good idea, it's like, oh, I now hadn't thought about that. And that's what's so interesting about our jobs. And every film is different. We go into a whole new world. And so it's never dull. It's always new.
And so consequently, yes, that I think that we are also kind of being hired. My agent said something very interesting. It said, at this point in our careers, we're really not being hired. We're no longer being hired for our resumes any longer, that our resumes kind of speak for themselves. Why Daniel and I are here is for our ingenuity. And so the fact that we can collaborate and sort of bring good ideas that the director is receptive to, that kind of carries this thing further. And one of the things that I love, which was a contribution that Daniel had made in a scene that's very pivotal in the picture, where Travers is really trying to demonstrate to the Shermans and to DeGrotti that she truly has dominance over this process, that she does have veto power, that she decides very arbitrarily that she doesn't want the color red in the film, which was always a very interesting moment, but it was Daniel's brilliant idea for that scene to put Jason Schwartzman, who is one of our most endearing characters in the picture, in a bright red sweater vest. And so these are things that are not on the page, but when you have strong collaborators who are reading in subtext and who can each be contributing little things that are going to help reinforce that point, then I think really sort of that synergy, it's like playing in a band in some ways. And so it's great to play with other musicians who are of a like mind, but then who can also switch keys and tempos just as quickly as the director wants to.
So do you have in a picture like this where there's some things that are very familiar and some things that aren't to the audience,
mm-hmm.
As opposed to something like Game Change, where almost everything is familiar to your audience, more difficult? Is it kind of easier when you don't have quite as much preconceived notion of what P.L. Travers is going to look like and what her world is going to look like versus, say, Walt or Disneyland? Or
well, I would say that even in Game Change, there were things that people didn't think about Sarah Palin, you know, being with her family. You know, I thought it was a very balanced view of Sarah Palin. Mm-hmm. So we got to see her sort of behind the scenes, where I think most people haven't. You know, they see the photo ops. So it's the same in this. And it, for this, it was for Saving Mr. Banks, we were doing two different movies. You know, we did the whole 1906, and then we did the whole 1961. And that was challenging for us, because budget-wise, it's hard. And just spinning your wheels one way, and then all of a sudden moving into 1961, it's like it was a big jolt. But that's what makes it exciting.
And it really was like, it was like making two mini features. We made, yes, a 17-day Australia 1906 picture that wrapped on a Friday, and then on a Monday we started a Los Angeles 1961 picture, completely different cast, completely different everything, without really missing a beat. And you asked an interesting question about kind of how much archival information we're absorbing and what those expectations are. And to contrast something like Game Change with something like Saving Mr. Banks, while an audience may be sort of more familiar with what that archival reality is, by the time that Daniel and I started, we were incredibly familiar with what the archival reality of Australia and Allora in 1906 was, all the way down to newspaper stories that sort of delineated which events appeared, which attractions were at the fair where her father spoke. We actually have newspaper stories that have this. We had researchers from Australia. Actually, the house that P.L. Travers grew up in Allora stands today and is outfitted, is dressed as a museum as it existed in the time that she lived there. And so we had researchers in England, we had researchers in Australia, we had Disney archivist. We went to the Disney Family Museum in San Francisco. We went to the Disney Photo Archives. And so while these things may not be well known to the audience that's going to be seeing this film for the first time, these things were very well known to Daniel and I, sort of down to down to the minutia. And so the fact that we shared our research and we worked kind of back and forth together, it made for really kind of the standard that we were trying to meet wasn't a standard that was going to meet an audience's expectations. It was really a standard that was really more derived from the responsibility that both of us felt for the opportunity to kind of, there's only going to be one chance, we think, in our lifetimes to see Walt and Walt's office in a feature film. And we really felt sort of a tremendous responsibility sort of to one another, to the director, and to Disney to get this as right as we could.
So the reality for you guys, regardless of what the audience knows, is the reality.
Yes.
Always paramount, yes.
And it can be selectively edited by the director of what is germane to the story and what takes us off on a tangent that takes us out of the story.
And what I would say too is that most all the directors that we work with really sort of rely on Daniel and I to come in and do the heavy lifting. It was Daniel who had pointed me toward the Neil Gobler biography of Walt. And we also read Valerie Lawson. So he and I, we are reading and researching. The same thing with Game Change. We're reading and researching sort of in parallel. And what directors want is directors really want to understand kind of what the foundational realities are. And then from that point, then they can take the artistic license that they choose to help really refine and highlight the story points. The last thing the director wants is to have depicted something incorrectly from a place of ignorance rather than from a place of intention.
Mm. Yeah. So where do you guys get your most pleasure in the process?
I love being on the set. I think the best ideas happen on the set. Little changes, you can notice something and say, what if we did this? You know, but going even back to our research, it wasn't originally in the script, the maypole, but we found these incredible pictures of a maypole at that fair, and they switched it around so her little sister is going to be one of the maypole dancers, and I think it gave a really nice texture and an interest.
And so this is kind of a good situation where things that I'm finding that are through my independent research or through the researchers who are working under my umbrella are gathering images that then become germane and useful to you, and then you kind of become a stronger advocate, and then we as a united front can really begin kind of shaping these things that are really serving the story better, but we can do this in combination.
But it sounds like by the time you actually get to the set that your work, a lot of it's been done, and there's not as much improv on the set, or is that an incorrect?
That's a very correct assumption. But I guess the thing that Daniel's saying too is there is something that's very gratifying about all of this research and all of this pre-production, and also we are generally the first people on the project. We are the first ones hired because our research and our lead time takes much longer, and so we are really kind of at the front of the train together, kind of learning and discovering and exploring, and so we have a little more leisurely process to be bringing these things to the director, to be kind of talking through these broad concepts, to be kind of focusing. But then the morning when you have woken up with the first number on the alarm clock being a four, and have
or earlier when we were doing Disneyland,
and
we started dressing extras at 2 a.m.
and sort of driven for an hour in the dark, and so I think so there's something very gratifying about that first light falling on the set, and then to see Disneyland transformed because of the extras, to see the Aller Affair sort of finally come to life. So basically, Daniel's work and the people and the cast sort of breathe all of this life into the canvas and into the frame. But we never really get to see these things come together until that morning. These have all been theoretical. It's all been hypothetical. It all looks like it's going to work on paper. But then when you actually kind of see it all come together there in front of the lens, I think that's really where the magic is.
So in many ways, by the time you actually have film or footage to go into the cutting room with or whatever, you're already past that.
That's correct. Yes, because we are the first cars in the train,
right,
as it were. The cinematographer is toward the middle of the train, and our editor is sort of toward the back of the train, and sort of we are hired kind of in that particular sequence. And so yes, if we're arriving on the morning to be shooting, and all of our parts and pieces and elements are not 100% correct, then we have some questions. But then the other thing that is a reality is that we get to that point where we actually get to see it and breathe it in and enjoy it and really kind of have that moment. And then before that day is even halfway finished, we're dashing off back to be dealing with what's going to happen tomorrow. So yeah. We never really have the luxury of kind of being able to be there and luxuriate in our work. We kind of see it. We see it in fleeting. We make sure that it's on its feet and pointed in the right direction. And then you and I are kind of scampering off to make sure that the next day goes as well. And the next day, and the next day, and the next day.
And you, even given the directors you now work with on a regular basis, do you ever get surprised? Or have you guys are so much of the core of what's happening there in a given day of shooting that you kind of know what it's going to be?
I think for the most part we are surprised very little because we prepare so thoroughly.
Well, maybe more for me in that I have the actors who are arriving on the set for the first time, and they might have a great idea. Oh, I want a handkerchief in this scene. I think that's really the, I love doing that part. I love working with the actors and helping them create this character, and I feel very responsible to make sure, because they're playing the part. I'm dressing them, but they're playing the part, and if we can find that one thing that makes them really feel in the moment, that's our job, and it's very gratifying.
Are actors allowed to talk to you?
Absolutely. the bigger question, are we allowed to talk to them, I think, is another question. And certainly, and all actors kind of have a different degree I think that all actors prepare. I think each actor sort of has a different degree that they feel comfortable in interacting. Their interactions with you are really pretty baked into the process. Their interactions with...
I'm usually the first person that the actor meets.
And you know everything about them.
And I try and be prepared as possible to answer any of their questions about their character and the way their character, sometimes I feel like I'm more a psychologist. Where do they buy their clothes? Do they have their clothes made? Are they sloppy? Are they neat? Are they behind the times? Are they fashion forward? And it's building that character. What kind of shoes? Are their shoes worn out? And it's all of those little things that really, I think, help an actor bring their character to life.
We have conversations with actors all the time who, particularly with period pictures, will talk about how when they finally put on this part of the outfit, that's when they found their character, that it finally came to life.
But that can even be in a modern film, in modern clothes. It's the right shoes. Sometimes the shoes never show, but it's part of their character.
And while I'm creating an environment that's really serving two purposes, I'm creating a machine in which our cinematographer and our director are actually filming, the scenes and making the scenes happen. But at the same time, I'm also trying to create a complete environment that allows the actors to suspend disbelief a little bit, to grow a little bit deeper into the part by lieu of the fact that they are surrounded in an environment that they know to be a credible one. They know to be an archivally correct one, they know one that really feels right. So we always presume that an actor of Emma Thompson's caliber, of Tom Hanks' caliber, they're going to have done their homework as well. And so I think that, that without being too specific, for me, the idea of creating Travers Shawfield Street townhouse in London was very, very important because Emma was, even though we'd never really seen it, I think that we need the actors to come in and really feel like they're in the right place. This can't be, this has to enhance what they're doing rather than being a distraction from what they're doing.
And it was fun to watch her walk onto that set, and she picked up almost everything and looked at it and put it down very carefully where it was placed, mm-hmm. and just to familiarize herself mm-hmm. with her house. Mm-hmm. And it was gratifying to watch that someone so precise.
And so this also speaks to the amount of set decorator. This also speaks to the amount of preparation that my set decorator Susan Benjamin has done. So all of the research that Daniel and I have talked about, Susan has independently engaged in this. And so in the opening montage in Shawfield Street, the paintings were the paintings that Travers would have had. The small objects. And so we're really trying to sketch in a lot of backstory about what a complicated character she was, about what a traveled character she was, about all the different philosophies philosophies that her work embraced. And you really, this has to be a very quick shorthand thing to communicate these things very, very quickly and without words to an audience to kind of get through that expository part so the story can really begin being told.
And there's a lot of Travers subtext in this movie overall, Mary Poppins subtext and Disney subtext.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Is that all in bold in the script, or is that things that touches that were brought by the different departments along the way? Or?
And so I would say that it was kind of a process of exploration and discovery. That certainly Kelly Marcel wrote one of the most beautiful scripts that we've ever read that just leapt off the page. But then as we were beginning to explore how to really make the 1906 story and the 1961 story sort of run together. And what's really unusual about this picture, as opposed to there being most pictures with period flashbacks, really have a dominant present and a subservient past, where for Travers, as she gets deeper and deeper into the revisiting of her childhood, these stories begin to mix and match and tumble, and time becomes very permeable and malleable in some ways. And so we really kind of hit upon an idea of the recurring instance of iconic ideas such as palm trees in Maryborough that start the picture and end the picture, and then palm trees in Los Angeles. One of my favorites is the instance of the carousel horse, which is on the weather vane that actually opens and closes the picture, and yet we get to see another instance of a carousel horse in the Hour Fair, and then when we go and visit King Arthur's Carousel, there is yet another instance of a carousel horse. So whenever we can begin really kind of taking objects and ideas and bringing them from 1906 and 1961 and then from 61 back into 1906 and really kind of allowing the audience to sort of see this world through the protagonist eyes is really kind of a wonderful use of our tools.
But like, how much of that is in the script?
It's hard for us to actually remember, and so we don't really want to take anything away from Kelly,
from Kelly,
but certainly I would say that probably palm trees had really not been an embedded idea, and the notion that there was going to be a horse on the weather vane, and also this kind of ties into the horse that she and her father ride, and so I think that it was, you know, and you never really know, you know, I kind of like to see if we can reach into the writer's subconscious as well, and without this necessarily being anything that she was doing by intention, if we can be kind of picking up on these subtle cues and then transposing and highlighting them for the, you know, for the greater cumulative effect of the film, then that's really when our jobs get fun.
I'm not sure if the umbrella belongs to you, for instance, or somebody else had to come up with that.
It's a collaboration. The umbrella?
The aunt's umbrella.
Yes.
And so that obviously connected to Mary Poppins.
To Mary Poppins. Mm-hmm. And her look and the length of her skirt and her hat.
And her big shoes.
And her shoes.
Yes.
Yeah, we wanted it to be the realistic version of Mary Poppins. Of P.L. Travers' drawing of Mary Poppins, even more than Julie Andrews' Mary Poppins.
So is that a matter of tweaking along the way, or did you kind of come up with an idea of where those...
Well, you look at the P.L. Travers book and the drawing of Mary Poppins, and you look at Julie Andrews, and then you look at the research of what a silhouette in 1906 would look like, and it's a combination.
And Rachel, I guess, also.
And Rachel. There's another thing that we do is that her father's ring, P.L. Travers is wearing her father's ring, which some people have noticed and most people don't. Mm-hmm. But there are close-ups of him with his ring, and then she wears the ring throughout the picture.
So is there anything harder about the prequel period, the 1906 period versus the 1961 period?
Well, it takes a lot longer to get everybody dressed by the time you corset them, so the lead time in the morning is quite a bit longer.
But a limited number of people, I guess, because of the budget on something like this, relatively.
Well, we had a lot of people at the fair.
Is that, is budget on a picture like this, where you have two periods?
Budget
is always paramount, regardless of the studio, regardless of the situation. Absolutely, that we both have a tremendous responsibility, and one of the things that kind of keeps us working in tandem is our ability to bring these numbers in where they need to be.
We like to spend the money where it's going to be seen, There's no, you know, there's no specialty coffee drinks allowed in the department.
And so essentially, kind of we go in and we negotiate. We negotiate with management in a responsible and in an informed way. We take as we accumulate or acquire as much in the way of assets to do our work with, and then our intention is to spend every penny and put every penny on the screen, yeah, and sort of walk away with an empty wallet and an empty gas tank at the end of the movie.
So do you ever walk into a situation where they say, okay, here's your budget, and you go, oh, good, we're this will be easy?
No, never.
Never.
There's always another way to...
Never.
Never. Here's the thing. You know, we work with production managers. They're not stupid. They know it. They know what things cost, or they'll ask you what things cost. And then it's a negotiation. All right, 20 less extras mm-hmm. in this scene, but then we can have 20 more in this other scene. And then the director will come in and say, no, I really need this, I really need that. And it's a collaboration, and that's, you know, that's our job.
And the same thing with the scenery as well, where I would have loved to have built Travers' hotel room at the Beverly Hills Hotel, mm-hmm. but this just wasn't going to be in the cards in some ways. And so we ultimately made a decision that would be location shooting. And so essentially we are always from a lump pile of money, from a lump sum that someone has predetermined long before we've been hired, that there's a number sitting on a bottom line somewhere, and Daniel and I are expected to bring the ingenuity to the process that is going to somehow make our number match that number.
Yes. Or explain to them why it shouldn't be that number in a concise way, why that number might be impossible.
Right, and then here again, our kind of our credibility, our experience, our ingenuity really kind of has us taken a little more at face value. We are heard, and we want to also give we want to acknowledge our producer Philip Stoyer and our line producer Philip Stoyer. We'd like to acknowledge our unit production manager Andy Keeter, who were both who kind of were presented with things that were probably beyond what they were expecting, but who also ultimately were open and embracing of what this needed to be without enabling this to become a runaway train or a picture of twice the size that it is. Yeah.
Well, none of the directors you guys work with on a regular basis are budget busters. They're all kind of known for being on time, on budget.
That's correct. No drama.
Yes.
Drama, smart.
And certainly, one of the things that the studio, that is expected of the studio is that Daniel and I are experienced enough to be able to kind of evaluate all of these moving parts and pieces and yet craft a solution that somehow lives, if not entirely under, but lives very closely under sort of the umbrella budget that's created for us.
So as we're going into the award season, what is the best compliment to you guys? Do you want people to say, hey, look at that costume, or hey, look at that design, that set, or do you want them to not notice it, or do you want, what is...
So I'm of two minds on this, and so I always adhere to the adage that the audience does not leave the theater humming the scenery. So by that token, I really want my work to be kind of the canvas that the cinematographer is painting upon, that the actors are doing their work within. So the more invisible I can be, the better. So that's one standpoint. And then the other, on the flip side of that coin, is when I read reviews that talk about the entirety of the motion picture, which was largely done on sound stages, if you want to call them that, in enhanced warehouses in Santa Cruz, Clarita. I love seeing reviews that talk about how all of that was shot entirely on the Disney lot. So on one hand, you kind of seek the recognition a little bit, but on the other hand, you are just so gratified that you have fooled these smart critics into thinking that what they're seeing is occurring naturally and is occurring organically, which I think ultimately is our goal.
Well, in this picture in particular, those of us who've been around for a little while have been on this lot a lot, mm-hmm. and are used to the animation building and mm-hmm. what it looks like, and the hallways of it and the dopey drive and everything else. Mm-hmm. So it is remarkable how clean and efficient it was. And as you said, you shot Beverly Hills Hotel for itself, I guess, or maybe shot a different hotel. But you did build Walt's office.
We did build Walt's office. We built the rehearsal room. And then back to Beverly Hills Hotel. The Beverly Hills Hotel is very respectful of the privacy of their guest. And their porte-cochere is really the only true drop-off and pick-up point. And so we never set foot on the property of the Beverly Hills Hotel at all, not even with a paint chip or a fan deck or a tape measure that we respected. We respected that privacy. There had been a book published that year, which I believe was the 100th anniversary of the Beverly Hills Hotel. So we had tremendous archival photography that had come our way. And really the green awning of the porte cochere, where we see kind of all the drop-offs and pickups in the film, was actually recreated from the defunct or empty Robinson's May Company over by the Beverly Wilshire Hotel, which Daniel and I knew very well from our work on Frost Nixon. And so I knew there was a big cantilevered awning that was kind of sitting over there, kind of empty and quiet and controllable and by itself. And all I needed to do was find a clever way of extending that out over what their parking situation was going to be. Right. And that enabled us to shoot all those scenes day or night without really interrupting a hotel's operation. And then the Langham Hotel in Pasadena, which stood in for the interiors, had a much more flexible drop-off and pick-up arrangement. And so we were able to do our interiors of the Beverly Hills Hotel at the Langham, and then the scenes where Travers throws the pears into the pool and then sits by the pool at nighttime. Mm-hmm. But then we had to basically take that and, using very clever and very subtle visual effects, sort of take a white contemporary looking hotel and turn it back into a pink 1961 condition.
Well, that was one of the few things, actually. We shot during the junket day at the Beverly Hills Hotel.
Oh, really?
And noticed that the pool, you could not throw pears in the pool from anywhere.
Yes, yes. There was not a public space.
You can't really throw pools at the Langham Eye. Pears in the pool. You'd have to have quite a reach.
Actually, I take it back. You can, from the balcony that we put Emma on.
Really?
Yes, and she has a hell of an arm, ladies and gentlemen.
If you
look at that shot, basically that shot starts underwater with pears coming through the frame. It actually booms up and breaks the water line up to Emma on a second or third floor balcony, and she makes the perfect sort of long outfielder play and sort of puts it right at home plate.
And for you, the awareness of your work for the public?
As a costume designer, we set the time and the place and the character. And it's nice for people to notice, but you know, in this movie, you don't want anybody to say, "Oh my God, you know what a great costume she," you know, and on the other hand, you want that as well, like, "Oh, this was perfect for the character," you know, and that she is a handsome, formidable woman, and I think that's what people come away with, and that's gratifying.
Well, it is, as you said earlier, talk about the cape or the jacket, and particularly her shoe as it starts tapping.
Yes.
You know, John really shot those things in ways that really were significant in her picture.
Yes, she also has a scene when she comes back to Walt's office for the premiere, and she did this thing where she turned around, put her hand on her hip, and, you know, flew her cape open to show her suit, and I was like, "Wow, that was great." And she said, "I did that for you, darling."
And you talk about, you know, the kinds of discussions that happen in pre-production, and we knew that there was the tapping. We knew there was a tapping of the toe, the tapping of the foot, when this is for Fly a Kite. And one of the things that I had discussed with John Lee earlier on, and this is just this great, it's almost like improvisational musicians who can all just kind of play and sort of wander and meander. So we knew that there was probably going to be a shot of her foot tapping, which there really beautifully is. And I had pitched to John Lee, what if she makes a decision at that moment to step from the linoleum floor, the green linoleum floor, which was really kind of the source of conflict. This is where the writer's table was, and whenever she'd been on that wood dance floor before, she was always criticizing storyboards. There was never anything that happened well for her on that wood floor. And we talked about a shot where she actually leaves one threshold and enters another. And then when we get into this great collaborative filmmaking, there's a beautiful shot in the film, which is Tears My Heart Out. Don DeGrati extends her hand, and then we actually see her in those shoes sort of step from one thing across a threshold, across a portal, into an acceptance of what's going on.
And when you go to opening night and you see the picture all put together and it's done, how do you feel?
Gratified. And I have to say, I get caught, in this film especially, I just got caught up in the story, and people would say, oh, what about, I'm like, oh, I don't remember, you know, I don't remember what shoes she had on, but I remember the moments of the film.
Right.
So when a movie can do that for us, it's an amazing feat.
And this was a particularly interesting picture because of the complexity of the interlacing of the two stories. This was one that was very, very difficult for us to pre-visualize, but to pre-imagine emotionally how these pieces and parts are all going to work
and be edited together.
Yeah. And so much of the picture, you know, is, you know, and really follows Kelly's screenplay and draft, but to actually see those things actually intercut. And there was, when I read the script the first time, the thing that really struck me the most, at first I was kind of thinking, wow, this is so delicious. I'm going to get to do Disneyland. I'm going to do Walt's office. We're going to do Australia. But then when we were doing the Fidelity Fiduciary Bank song, and when Colin Farrell starts singing the words that the Shermans are writing, I knew we were in a very different territory, just emotionally, psychologically, intellectually, intuitively, and all those. And so to understand, you know, you're never going to know how that moment is going to work until you can actually just see it. There's no way to tell from the page. There's no way to tell from being on the set, because these were separated by hundreds of miles.
Yes.
And weeks and weeks and weeks of shooting. And so it's very, very exciting.
John Lee Hancock.
Yes.
But it must be kind of a pleasure to see it work.
Unbelievable. Yes, to see
absolutely.
It work. Yes, yes.
Absolutely. The nice thing was, before we started shooting, Colin Farrell, who's in the first part of the movie, and a lot of the other actors are in the second part of the movie, he had a little party at his house, and he showed us all Mary Poppins. Mm-hmm. And so that the two groups could meet each other, because they never have any scenes. He never has scenes with his daughter, you know, Emma. So it was kind of a really wonderful sharing moment for everybody.
Well, surreal, I imagine.
Yeah. It was kind of surreal to go to the AFI screening and watch the movie in the Chinese theater where we shot, and then they're in the Chinese theater
right.
And we're watching them.
Yes, to go to a premiere having...
It's kind of magical.
Yes, and John Lee talks about sort of things just kind of folding in on themselves again and again and again. And so, yes, almost a year to the day that we walked through the Chinese theater sort of dressed for the premiere for the AFI, a year prior to that, we had been dressing the Chinese theater to match the premiere from 1964.
Yes.
And so just really kind of all of these amazing parallels and amazing overlaps and amazing things turning in on themselves.
The one thing that I had to do was I just assumed at Disneyland and at the premiere, all of the Disney characters were in the archives, and they're not. So we had to recreate the 1961 Mickey Mouse and the 1961 Goofy and the 1961 Penguins and the 1964 Penguins. So that was that became a big part of our budget and a big part of our time spent researching and getting the color of Mickey's face right and the color of his tie and the shape of his tie. And we spent lots of many hours.
And really that goes back to sort of the richness and the depth and kind of just the quality of the Disney photo archives, where we knew kind of, you know, and we love the end credits of the picture that actually sort of proved that Travers was there and those were what the penguins looked like. But so we would get glimmers of these things and, you know, shots and fragments from the actual 1964 premiere, but then Daniel would have to kind of dive back in and look at what was going on, we'd be cross-referencing to Disneyland at the time to see what those characters looked like, and so we were able to really kind of move from different archival instances of, okay, this is, we need to kind of harvest this from the Disneyland portion of this, we need to harvest this from the premiere portion, we need to harvest this from the making of portion, and so just to have all of that access, to have that depth of research and quality, really kind of set the bar very high for us.
And the Disneyland days, many of the crew members brought their families to be extras. So there's this great shot of Emma and Tom. It's in a lot of the publicity photos, and it is our key grip's wife and kids standing behind them And so it really became such a fun day for the whole crew because all their families were there, their kids were there. And a lot of the crew members who grew up in Southern California were like, oh my God, this is just like when I went to Disneyland for the first time in 1961. With my family, and my dad had a tie.
And then among the most important children that were there that day were John Lee Hancock's two children, and then one of the featured extras, we were talking about Leanne Toohey, the woman played by Sandra Bullock in The Blind Side, because we got to be very close with Leanne. Leanne came on that day to just lend a bit of that Blind Side karma to our day, and so Daniel got to dress Leanne, who
is... Slightly different outfit.
In a totally, we gave her cat's eye glasses, made her
a print dress.
And a print dress. Which would never be caught dead in.
Gloves? White gloves?
White gloves.
Yes. You finally got to remake Leanne Toohey.
Yes.
So how fun for us to have her in both contexts that way.
Yeah. Absolutely.